Hey guys, I'm Tim.
I'm Bob.
I'm Dan.
And I'm Spencer.
And this is the Board Game Rundown. Today, we have a very special guest, star creator, host of the Board Game Mechanics.
It's pretty okay.
They're pretty okay. We talked about them. Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry guys, it's not Katie. We actually have Jason with us.
Yeah. Sorry to disappoint. Yeah. Hey guys.
But yeah, so we've got Jason with us. We're trying out, we're experimenting. We're trying to be able to Skype in people. Jason agreed to be our guinea pig to get this started. Because he's a pretty okay guy. Mm-hmm. So, we are going to talk about games we played, news, crowdfunding, and we've got a topic picked by Jason himself that we were going to get into specifically.
So but far, first, complaints. Make sure you're liking, subscribing, and ringing that bell to get all of our notifications.
That's right.
Yep. And so that way, when Dan says something that's going to be out in the next 2 days, you know, it's
where it's coming. We'll obviously have a link in the description to Jason's Board Game Mechanics channel as well.
Oh, so if you don't,
I'm not going to say if you like him, but if you don't hate him,
let's set the bar there.
If you want to see Katie, you can go check out the video.
Exactly.
Right. That's right. And then, Bob, what else? Come on, you're missing one thing that you always hit. It's right in line with subscriptions. No? Okay.
We're doing a giveaway. Yeah, well, at least there we go. To you. And I'll throw it back to Tim.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So when we get to 500 subs, which we're getting real close, we are going to send you a copy of Edge of Darkness from AEG.
We're going to send free one of them.
Gratis.
One of them.
Not all 500.
Random person who has commented on the thread. Mm-hmm. We will pick somebody from there. So drop in. Let us know like what your favorite AEG game is. If you don't have one, pick one you'd like to play. Mm-hmm. It could be Edge of Darkness, because then you might get a chance to play it.
Mm-hmm. It'd be very smart if you entered the giveaway that you wanted to play Edge of Darkness. That would help.
That would help.
Maybe you just want a cool gift to give someone.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So I know Jason's taking a lot of the light here because he's the guest, but also I just got back from vacation, so that was cool. I'm not going to talk about it that much. maybe I will. But I got to say, for games we played, guys, we brought a bunch of games. We didn't really play much. We spent a lot of time just relaxing and just out on the farm.
Sounds miserable.
You know, just having a nice outdoor vacation.
You mean
and
kind of a bit of a
stuff.
Barnyard grab type of thing?
Oh, yeah, boy. I guess we were grabbing and we were at a barn.
I think we're done here.
Stop.
Before we start an OnlyFans.
Stop. That's not what I meant.
Okay, so Jason, we start off with some games we played. I know you get a lot of games played.
Yeah, I'm kind of jealous.
Well, yeah, I'm jealous.
First off, I'll never go on vacation with Dan if there's going to be some grabbing.
Right, agreed.
That's probably a fair assessment.
I did play some games. One game you guys like quite a bit, and that's Growl.
I love Growl.
You got to play some Growl. So, five-player game of Growl. We played the 10 coins. It actually went pretty quick because one round somebody got 7.
Wow.
Now, the people you're playing Growl with, had they played before?
No, they never played. It's some of Katie's family. They just hung out with us this weekend. They're like, hey, let's play some games. So we busted that out. And it went over pretty well. So
that was my question. Yeah,
the person who got 7, was that you?
It was not. No. Like,
I was giving him coins.
I've loved seeing.
Just setting you up.
I've loved seeing the change, and you can see this on our Facebooks, which ours is in the description. Jason's, I'm sure, is in the description of his videos and stuff, right? But it's been funny seeing the change of the first time we got Jason to play Growl, and it's like, I don't like this kind of game, and he almost kind of slept through it. Of just like, kind of, you know, you weren't like into it, right? Like you were kind of just like, I don't really like this kind of game, and then you were like, I guess that was pretty cool, and like we played a second round and blah, and then like just seeing this gradual like now he has to say the whole like, I mean, I guess it's pretty good for a social deduction game.
we got our hooks in him.
Yeah, it's been cool seeing that change over time.
Bring him over to the dark
Growl,
side.
Great game.
Yeah. Okay. So, what else did you play? Sorry, that was a big tangent on Growl.
I played Nidavellir. I don't know if you've played that.
I've only seen it on your Facebook.
Yeah, I've heard of it.
On Board Game
Mechanics. So it's like a drafting game and auction game where you're trying to recruit these different suits of dwarves, I think.
Okay.
And you're just trying to score the most points. It plays really quickly. No matter if you're playing 2 or 5, it's over in like 30 minutes.
Nice.
It's amazing.
I like that. I like that a lot.
Yeah.
That's cool. I also played A Gentle Rain, which is a little solo tile game.
Okay.
Is that R-A-I-N?
Everybody and their mom got that one. Get sent to them, I guess. I don't know.
Oh, yeah, not us. We're not, you know, we're still below
maybe
that.
Maybe your mom got it.
Somebody call my mom.
Okay.
Do you want me to keep going? You want to say some? I don't know.
No, it's fine. Go through your list.
Go through your list. You're fine.
All right. I also played The Feds, which is a new game from Dr. Finn.
Oh, yeah.
It's coming out. It's Kickstarter in July. Little 2-4 player, like, area control game, which is pretty slick. Kiwi Chow Down. which is on its way to your place.
I just got it. So, yeah, nice. We will be checking that out.
Nice.
Amerigo from Steffenfeld, which is the Cube Tower action selection.
That's a classic.
Tile,
we might actually have that on the shelf back here.
I saw
it's really good.
Yeah.
And the last one I played is Batman Gotham City strategy game.
I saw you posting about that. Yeah, he seemed to like it.
It's good.
Yeah,
it has good.
I saw the sentence. It did not disappoint, I think.
See, I was
said,
worried because I thought this is, looks like an amazing game. It's got to be disappointing.
Right. But,
right. Well, it was a little long, a little mean, but it was still enjoyable.
Okay. Well, when I first saw your pictures, I thought you were playing Gotham City Chronicles. And I'm like, what is he doing with that game?
Yeah.
Because that is like all minis.
It's all minis.
Oh,
yeah.
That one. Oh. Like,
but all right, Bobby, what do you got? What did you play?
Unfortunately, my list is really small. I played some Spirit Island online.
Right on.
Yep, with the new expansion. And then I played a bunch of Magic. That's it for boring.
Man, you are light.
That was a light.
You were light.
Week. Yeah.
I
worked a lot.
I exposed some new people to Lords of Vegas.
Nice.
And Doobie, do you know how many points Doobie got in that game?
Do I even want to know? How many?
Two.
Oh my God.
The whole game. My brother-in-law only scored 2 points in Lords of Vegas.
That's funny.
Did you teach it?
Yeah.
He had already known how to play.
Dang.
He already knew how to play. Can't blame me. Yeah, he just kept having casinos taken away from him. And
we all been there.
It was really good, though, man. Lords of Vegas is
how many
such a good game. 5 players.
Nice.
So we had a 5-player game of Lords of Vegas.
Yeah, it's a really cool mediocre game.
It is a great game that Dan hates because he has bad taste.
Yeah, because it's got luck in it. So can't have any games.
Every
with luck.
Game that's not a Euro has luck in it. No comment, right?
Yeah.
Got to play our preview copy of Barnyard Grab a couple of times.
Yep.
That is nice. I forget the name of the company that put
talk
that.
About the fastest game I think I've ever played.
South Shore Games.
Yeah, it was quick.
These guys, they jokingly, they were at our protospiel, their local guys. Actually, Rob Kerr, who designed Concluzio.
Right, yeah. One of our favorites here.
Co-designer of that game. Mm-hmm. And we got to play it at protospiel, like, what, a year ago?
No, it's two now, right?
A year and a half ago. No, we had protospiel before COVID.
Did we?
Yeah, barely.
Okay.
But anyways... We got to play it, and it plays so fast that they say you could play this game and use it to determine first player. Mm-hmm. Because we were done in like 3 minutes.
It was insane.
I mean, I'd won, and I didn't even realize it. It took me like 3 rounds later. I'm like, oh, wait. It was for 3 points. Yeah.
So you're simultaneously, everybody's rolling their dice, and you're getting whatever the die says. So whether it's a cow or a pig or a sheep or stealing something from somebody else. And then whenever you meet the requirement for one of those, you just say sold, dump off your board, grab a coin. And you start rolling again.
I didn't roll a thief once.
Weird.
Yeah.
But anyways, it's an awesome game. Awesome little game. And then we did get a chance to play before we started that Daimyo Sanso.
Yeah.
So that is a territory control game set in what? Feudal Japan?
Feudal Japan, yep.
And so what? Okay.
Sengoku period.
Thank you.
I like that, like the program movement. On
so
that.
Yeah, so yeah. It's like a map of Japan. Everybody's got unique factions. There is on the board. There is an actual like program moves for everybody already laid out. So you basically move, you deploy, or you attack, and you've got 4 of those each
year.
But each person will have them in a different
order.
In a different order, right. And it's always the same order for everybody. Like my order is always the same every year, right?
Yep.
And Bob's is the same every year.
Attack, move, attack, deploy. And you would have been deploy, attack, move.
Right.
Things like that.
Right. And so it was pretty interesting. Mm-hmm. I think that the game still needs like a little bit of cooking, but we've got it in a pretty early
stage.
Mm-hmm. I want to say, Jason, you commented on the post Tim put about it saying like that seems like a game up your alley or something like that.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
I was going to say, did you not think it looked... like your kind of game, because after playing it, it's so just pure tactical Euro-y kind of thing.
Yeah, there's like no luck.
Yeah, there's like no luck. So
it didn't look like it. It looked like it was going to be nothing but like a light scale war game, and I'm definitely out on that.
It's definitely
so
it's
Euro game's cool.
I don't think it's a war game, but
war game.
Yeah, it's like it's a Euro. It's area control. You know, it's just like a area control game with this interesting program thing. That's by far my favorite part. That set program where you just have to. Which leads into a negative I have, which we won't go into too much, right? We'll cover that game later and play it more and stuff. But, like, the game does feel like there because of the pre-programmed turns, it does feel like there's almost always a smartest move. Okay, well, I have to attack this turn. Here's the board state. Where's the smartest place I should attack? Right. So that goes into that. But I love that idea of us having different preset programs every year to where it's like, okay, I have to move next.
And I know he's going to deploy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then you can look ahead and, okay, well, here's the turn order for next season. Yeah, so like I like that a lot. But I got to say, after playing it again, I don't know you as well as other people maybe, Jason, but it seemed like you'd enjoy it. I don't know.
And we used bits from Caverna.
Yeah.
I was wheat.
My one gripe with it was I'm not certain all of them place well. They're not equal placement.
I agree with that a little bit, at least in the five-player game that we played, that it felt like I started on the far left, nowhere
around
anyone. So I was able to build up
spread
and kind of turtle
out
to where Jeff and Bob started between three other armies.
Yeah, it's
kind of
like
Game
of Thrones. Sometimes you can really get hosed by
which started again, where I only had one way to go, and it was immediately blocked off, and there were no points near me.
Which, Game of Thrones, though, I assume this is based on the actual dynasty locations or whatever,
probably.
And so some had it better off. Yeah,
Jeff says it is.
So again, I am 100% okay with that. You just have to know that going into the game. You have to tell people, hey, just so you know, historically, you started at a disadvantage, you know, but you were better at your fighting timing, so work on that.
They can actually balance it by saying this one who's stuck in a corner and can't do anything gets a more powerful ability that balances that out.
If you look at all the cards, and I think with multiple plays, we would probably see some of that
come through. It could be.
Right.
But yes. So we played Daimyo Sanso. Lords of Vegas, played Barnyard Grab, and I played something else, and now I can't remember what it was.
Okay, well, I didn't play too much. I was able to play Tales of the Arabian Nights. I love that game, and I will say now in this section as well, I did wind up backing Smersh.
Nice.
Agents of Smersh. It's
Dan's shaking his head.
Do you not like Tales of the Arabian Nights, Jason?
From what I've heard, that game is everything that would make the feature of my list.
Oh, okay. I can see that, I guess. I agree that if someone said it's not really so much a game as it is this just
choose your own adventure.
Yeah, it's this choose your own adventure role-playing experience,
mm-hmm,
right? And I the way it comes together, like I was so happy that we played it in just two players, right? Which I think two or three players is probably the best way to play it anyway, because you're just a small group handing the book around. Everyone always has something to do in those smaller groups. Like in a two-player game, it's literally when I'm taking my turn, she's doing the book. When she's taking her turn, I'm doing the book. It's perfect,
now
right? And
yeah,
it obviously makes the game take a lot less time too.
Yeah.
But I just there's just something about it. Like even when I just end up robbing the wrong person and I end up in jail for three turns, and then you're like trying to hope that the jailer comes to your cell drunk that day so that you can trick him into like, you're like, okay, well, I have this skill, so I'll trick him today. Like, it feels so fulfilling to me. I love that game.
I like that concept.
And so Smersh now takes that and makes it cooperative, which makes it less a big problem, with Tales of Arabian Nights is if you get stuck in prison and stuff, people have a problem with that. I will say, if you're that kind of person, the game's not for you. Maybe don't play it. But like, people get stuck in prison for five turns, which would be 45 minutes or something, and they're trying to get out of prison, and they're like, wow, I did nothing. And it's like, yeah, but that's life, and I love it. And so with Smersh being cooperative, it kind of eliminates that. If one person's getting stuck, other people can help and start doing stuff like that. It also, instead of just relying on, do you have deception? No? Okay, you suck. In Smersh, there's a dice rolling skill check mechanic where,
you always have a chance?
You always have a chance.
You try to fake it.
Yeah. Because you're trained spies,
gotcha.
So you know everything. You just might not be as good.
Well, I mean, clearly I know everything.
Right.
And you're not as good.
But anyway, enough about Smersh, right? We played Tales of Arabian Nights, and we played it again the next day because we had such a good
What's really funny, though, is knowing what our topic is, and we haven't gotten into it yet, is I'm looking at Jason, and I'm going, that's checking a box. That's checking a box.
No,
that's
totally
checking
fine.
A box.
I get it. Again, it's such a weird, it's almost hard to call it a game. Right.
It's not a game. You're right. You're right.
Right. I'm okay with that if you really want to be a child. But
we'll just go right to Spencer.
Well, I'll just cut back in. Hey, edit. I played Conclusio.
Right on.
A couple
good
times.
Game.
We just mentioned it a second ago. I just love that game. I literally can't describe how simple that game is to play, but how like fulfilling it is. Right. Like you really feel like you did something, when you win that game or when you're one turn away, which I guess is the only negative for Conclusio, which is such a stupid negative, is that you do feel it's almost always
too short.
No, it's almost always like Tim's going to get on this turn. I know it. If I had one more turn, I'd get it too. Right. Sure. It's always so close that you almost feel like, is player order a factor? Is this a factor? Right. But I don't know. I love that game so much. But right, yeah, Conclusio, we talk about it all the time. Simple little deduction game. Check it out, please. It's so worth your time.
Mm-hmm. All right, Spencer.
I only got to play one game, but it's a very long game.
Oh, boy.
Tainted Grail.
Oh, yeah.
The last time. So expect to hear that from me for a while.
Sure, you're playing through a campaign right now.
Because you're trying it solo, right?
I'm soloing it in the campaign. I'm bringing in two characters. I might switch out which characters. I'm not certain yet.
Are you running with Maggot and somebody else?
No.
Because Maggot's really good.
Maybe I should.
Maggot?
Yeah, that Maggot is the name.
He's like
of
the magician one, right?
Yeah.
Sounds great.
Yeah, I'm thinking about that. I was using Neom.
He's a good babysitter, too.
I like Flea. He's a good babysitter.
And the other girl, I forgot her name.
I know who you're talking about, but yes.
The green one.
Dimebag's also.
Oh, Gamora. Yeah, Gamora.
He's not around anymore.
Nope.
Jesus.
So, yeah, I played Tainted Grail.
Well, I actually just remembered. I didn't write it down, but Catherine told me that I forgot to write it down, and I still didn't write it down. We also played Sonar.
The
two-player version of Captain Sonar.
Yeah.
It's a cool game. Captain Sonar, I think, is a much more fun game, but getting eight people is, how you say, extremely difficult. So playing a nice two-player version, it's still a super fun game. Just definitely different.
So we played a five-player game of Between Two Castles of Mad King Ludwig. That was the game I forgot.
Oh, okay.
And what's funny is I was playing with some people that hadn't played before, and my sister-in-law is like, I don't get it.
She does that all the time.
And then she won.
Yeah. She says it all the time. I don't understand what I'm doing. What's high score mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Because my castle was I had a castle with my wife, mm-hmm. and ours was like 52 points.
My wife.
And then Karen and I's castle was 55 points. Mm-hmm. But Karen and her husband, Sean, their castle was like 54 points. Mm-hmm. So, you know what I mean? So she beat me like barely by like 2 points. Because I was like, man, I got good. I got good scored castles. Like, I'm right real close together in points. And then, the whole time. I don't know.
I like that one.
I don't know. But yeah, I really like it. And actually, Jason, you lucky dog, I'm so jealous. Jason is going to get to review the expansion for that.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, I was going to say. Yep.
Cool. Lucky.
Yeah. I like this game, not as much as you guys. Yeah. And it always seems like I get stuck next to somebody who's never played before.
No, you idiot.
It's terrible.
Yeah.
Yeah. Instead of your normal like 30.
Yeah. See, right. I can do terrible on my own. I don't need you to help me. Right.
I will say, in all fairness, if you're sitting as someone who's never played before, it's the easiest game to teach them while you're playing ever. You just say, "Oh, we need another basement." You know, and they just say, "Okay."
Or what's a basement?
Yeah. Right. If you're playing with that person, maybe
you might be in trouble.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Might be in trouble. All right. So moving on past games we played, mm-hmm. you want to get into some news?
Yes.
Sure. And, guys, I have been out of Board Game Rundown for like 3 weeks now, I think.
Suspension.
I have no idea what has been going on in the board game news and industry. So educate me. What's happening?
Well, if you'd watch the show, you would know.
Well, I did watch the show, but
did you?
Instantly, I have to do all the annotation stuff.
So
I have to watch it.
I have some news. It's
go
not,
first, and I'll jump in.
Okay, so
okay, great.
We've
news.
Heard
Sorry.
Of Gen Con 21.
I've heard of it.
Asmodee's dropping out.
Okay,
Asmodee's dropping out of
Asmodee's
Gen Con.
Dropping out of Gen Con.
Okay, that
along
is news.
With Paizo, Yellow, Peterson Games, and Lucky Duck.
Oh no, that's a big hit. Then.
Yeah.
I assume this is
that was all this week.
COVID related.
I'm guessing.
I'm just assuming.
So they're doing it in favor of a virtual conference or convention.
Yeah.
Which I wasn't able to look up the stuff from the virtual convention, but that's what I saw.
I think I'm just an old fuddy-duddy, and I'm like, I'm not sure I'm comfortable trying to figure out how to do a virtual con.
Yeah.
Well, just look at all the, you know, extremely successful ones that have happened to him and do them like that.
Where, like...
There's been a bunch
Pick
of
a good one
and
do that.
Really? But are they?
Not,
really?
Not as successful.
Are they? Are they
well,
not
sure.
Successful?
As successful, sure.
And I mean, was like, this is the year I actually wanted to get to go to my first like gaming convention. Mm-hmm. And then they're all dropping out.
Well, and I usually go and work for the Peterson Games booth.
Yeah, right.
So I will get to see some of my good friends over there. But
Let it be known, next year, it's Con Central. We're going to do as many cons as we can.
Yeah, we're actually going to try to have some representation. Yeah.
Be careful,
like rundown
be careful
representation
with the promises. We have no idea which world war we're
going to
be
I'm going anyways.
That is true. All right, Spencer, what else you got?
Oh, well, you've heard. Everyone knows about Dominion.
You've heard of Dominion.
You've heard of Dominion.
How about Dominion Digital? Is that what you're going to say?
say they came out with a new version of the Dominion Digital by the same people who did the AI for Roll for the Galaxy and Race for the Galaxy.
Okay. So that's why you know about
that.
That's why
I know about it. Simple, very simple digital versions, but they work. People
well,
it's text-based,
one, basically. Yeah, well, the others have all failed. And this one, they're like, well, we think it's actually going to make it. Maybe it will, maybe it won't, but...
Sure.
Great business decision.
Great business decision.
Maybe it'll work.
Yeah. Well, I heard the AI is going to be a lot more difficult.
Yeah, it's going to be really killer AI, and that's probably what's going to bring some people in.
Okay. Right. Yeah, I think like it's being done by like Skynet.
Okay. 2 seconds.
I didn't even get that.
Is the AI going to make the game fun?
Yeah. Oh, low blow.
Hey, I actually completely agree. You should try a game called Arctic Scavenger.
Yeah, it's way better.
Great. It is.
Have you guys heard of DC Deck Builder? No. I've never talked about it.
I'm good.
Let me tell you. What else you got, Spencer? Is
that's
that it?
That's good. News.
That's good. Okay, so this basically is just apropos of we have done a video, a tutorial of it. But Renegade Games has been making puzzles. So they've announced they're going to have two T-Dragon Society puzzles. They're illustrated by the series creator, Kay O'Neill. So if you're into T-Dragon Society and that's kind of your thing, there's some cool puzzles coming out, being put out by the game company.
T-Dragon Society... half of the amount of how to plays we've done on this channel so far.
Gulp.
Go check out Tim's first attempt at a how to play with T-Dragon Society.
You make it sound like it was bad. It actually turned out pretty well.
It was pretty good. It was pretty good. I've said from the beginning, I thought it was pretty good, but it's just, you know, that's our first attempt. Tim had no idea what he was trying to do really like way back when. That was the beginning of the channel, right?
Yeah, you make it sound like I know what I'm doing now.
Well, good point.
Okay, moving on. Prospero Hall is striking again. With Goonies Never Say Die.
This one.
So it's an asymmetrical co-op with 1v many. So one is going to play the Goondocks Master, right? And they are going to be in charge of the Tertellis and skeleton pirates and laying traps while the Goonies are trying to accomplish various quests, whatever. I'm like hit or miss with Prospero Hall. Like they're really good at like doing the theme stuff, but I always kind of feel like their games are very surface level. Mm-hmm. So really accessible and family friendly, but if you require a little more depth to your games or a little crunchier a game, it may not be as satisfying. I guess hollow calories, right? Mm-hmm. Empty calories.
Right.
But yeah, I mean, as usual with all their other stuff, production looks great. Mm-hmm. Looks like it's going to be really well made.
I did see a little bit of Hufflepuff about that, where like the base characters that come with the game are the basic Goonies, right? The four kids and then Sloth. And then if you want to get the expansion, then you can
be Bran.
Bran and the two girls that are adventuring with them and whatnot.
Right.
But why is that Ravenclaw?
No, what? Because...
Ravenclaw?
Hufflepuff, can I
say? Oh, Hufflepuff.
Yeah, it's a joke.
Hufflepuff.
But no, really, why is that?
Some people were upset that the girls weren't included in the base game and you could only be a male character.
Oh, I didn't even think of that.
I hadn't either. Like, to me, it kind of made sense with the four base characters.
Right.
You know, and then you add the expanded characters in with the expansion. But then they added in Sloth, who's not really one of the main characters.
Right, but he's the face... of them.
it's kind of like having you as the face of our
right.
Show,
right? It's
like
same
Sloth.
Thing.
Right, thanks, buddy.
You're welcome. And then
yeah, I saw that one too.
Game Found. We love Game Found here.
Yes.
Game Found is the Elder Scrolls board game.
Oh yeah.
Being made by Chip Theory Games.
I've been watching this one for weeks
Chip Theory is Too Many Bones and really good production design and stuff. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be, I feel like Elder Scrolls is going to be in very capable hands.
Mm-hmm.
It will be interesting to see the physical weight of this game.
Yeah, because all those boxes are huge.
Too Many Bones weighs tons,
right? It is, yeah. Get those heavy chips in there.
And they're also really expensive. So
not cheap.
So we will see what that looks like when it comes out on Game Found. But I am excited to see that Game Found, not that I have anything against Kickstarter, but I'm excited to see that Game Found is like, continuing to be competitive with really interesting and big projects. I mean, that's huge.
Yeah, that's big.
Elder Scrolls.
It's huge.
It's like six games, including Skyrim and Elder Scrolls Online.
Right,
and
right.
The amount of backstory.
Yeah, there's so much lore
so
and
much lore.
Everything it's, you can dig in there.
Oh, come on, Dark Brotherhood.
Yeah. Yeah, so we'll see. I have no idea what kind of game it's going to be, what it's about.
Yeah, there's not a lot of... information about it. Quite
right.
Yet.
Plus,
yeah.
There's a Skyrim board game is coming to Kickstarter at some point in the future.
Yeah, just Skyrim, not like
just a Skyrim.
Right. Elder Scrolls in general.
So,
But anyways, it's coming out in June, so we are good. So anyways, Elder Scrolls.
Yeah. Elder Scrolls.
Yep. That's news. Yep.
Morrowind.
So you said you didn't know what kind of game it was. I bet it's a minis game.
What?
Not Chip Theory. Chip Theory, normally they just use a lot of like poker chips and stacks of chips to represent your health and wealth.
Oh,
so
that's
don't
right.
Make
so
minis.
It's gonna, yeah. All right. Got you. Right.
So they could do like standees or something.
Mm-hmm. It might make you, yeah.
So anyways, that's news.
Yep.
That's news.
News.
Oh, Jason.
Jason, you got any
got
news?
Any news over there, Jason?
I could say yes, but then that would be a lie. So
sure.
No, I don't have any.
I guess Man vs. Meeple is losing one of their hosts, one of their longtime hosts.
Are they taking
Jeremy is leaving. So if you're fans of that show and he is one of your favorite hosts,
too bad.
I don't know what to tell you.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I guess.
Learn to like the other hosts.
Right. No, you know, they do a lot. They're very prolific. They do. They have a lot of content. Mm-hmm. So good on them.
Yep.
They are active in the Indianapolis board game area, and they do a lot of nice things for the gaming groups down there. So so good on them. So it'll be interesting to see what kind of direction Man vs. Meeple goes in now. Cool. We're trying to get Dan to leave, but he won't.
Right.
So
right. Well, I don't want this show to also lose the best host. So
what? No, I'm going to still come if you leave. Okay, so let's get into crowdfunding then.
Oh. Yeah.
Spencer,
okay,
what Celtic Not Die themed game
do you have
this
week?
The Celtic Not Die themed game.
I just got some small ones here. I didn't see anything too crazy, at least not with enough time or with such limited time. Like we can cover it later.
Sure.
Right. The first thing I just wanted to talk about was you guys see, I guess there was an old, I actually had never seen this before. Everyone knows I like trivia games.
Uh-huh.
Evidently, there was an old like College Humor show or something called Actually.
Yep. Listen, if you listen to Board Game Mechanics, you would know that you're like way behind on this news.
Way to go.
Yeah.
Way to go. This was last week's news, sir.
No, we didn't talk about it on this show, right?
No, we didn't.
No, on this show. No,
okay, well, I don't care about their show.
Wow. You heard it here first, folks.
This is why we don't have nice things.
So we're going to talk about it on this show.
Uh-huh.
Because I've never seen them actually. Everyone knows I like trivia games, and this is just an interesting twist. Again, I just like a little interesting twist. So instead of just being asked a question, you get told the answer, but part of the answer is wrong. And so you have to respond by saying actually, and then correct the host's
this is in my house what we call Aberley storytelling.
Right.
Three people to tell the story, one person to tell it wrong, and two people to stand behind them and correct them.
All the things,
but you gotta push your glasses up as you go. Well actually
the upward finger.
Yes
point at how high above my your brain mine
so that's
is
on Kickstarter
there.
Now
yes, that is on Kickstarter by I didn't write it down. A Game of Nerdy Corrections until June 16th.
Okay.
When you guys have it till
it's probably way funded.
$32 to $54. This is a late one though. They're supposed to be delivering in August of next year. That's
sure.
a late one for such a simple trivia game.
Actually, yeah,
terrible. So yeah, they're a hidden mistake. There are 10 categories that your group chooses several of at the beginning of the game, so that everyone gets
has
a category
with.
That they will at least
sure.
want to play, even if they're still not great at it,
sure.
right? Mm. But yeah, that's there's literally nothing else to say about it, I think. It's just I love the idea of a new type of trivia game where now I just say, Tim, in the 1962 issue of Spider-Man, you know, he did this, and you go,
he
that
wasn't
did not
until
happen.
1964.
Yeah, yeah, and I love that idea. I absolutely love that idea. So that's
you
my
would.
First yeah. one, actually.
Dan likes to correct people.
He does.
Is that false
Bob, no, I don't.
Can I correct
I
people
like
by correcting their grammar? Does that count?
Still counts. All right, what else?
The other one I'm sure you guys probably aren't going to mention, so I'll just mention really quick because my mom backed it, and we played it recently. We haven't covered it yet, but we played Runes of Zun.
I was going to say this one.
Actually.
Okay. Yeah.
So new expansion coming out with a reprint and of all the other stuff, but there's a new expansion called Arcane Secrets. You have till June 3rd for this one, $15 for just the new expansion. It goes all the way up to $59 for the all in. July of this year, again, their turnaround is insane.
That's
and
awesome.
I'm going to tell you right now, that's a true turnaround because the last one was that fast, right?
Nice.
And this is just the expansion.
Nice.
So,
yeah.
But Runes of Zun, we will have that on the show eventually. We've played it a couple times now. Super simple card game where you're playing a card and then choosing who you affect with it and then applying stuff on people defending against
it. It's similar to Mini Steel.
Yeah, sure. Mini Steel-ish, take that kind of card game. The thing I like about
this one is
you pick a target in this game, so you can pick yourself and you create really crazy combos with that where you're playing cards and then like the last card you play, you choose yourself and that card says that person discards their whole hand and draws five cards. Okay, well, that was my last card I played. I have no cards. I discard none. I draw five. Now I can continue my turn again because I have a whole new set of cards to play with. Like, I just like that target system and the combos you can get from that. But yeah, Runes of Zun. We'll cover that eventually.
We should mention what comes in the expansion. There's
sure.
Six new action cards, a new reaction card, a new modifier type, and they're getting a whole bunch of promo cards, which they haven't unlocked yet.
Right.
So
those are like
go
the
back it
so
we can get
stuff,
the stretch goals. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Dan, you need to reach out to these people and say, hey, we talk about you on our show.
Yeah.
Send us stuff.
I don't think they need us to do that. But you know.
They got to get that board game rundown bump, though.
Yeah. They want three
seven people.
Other subscribers to back their game.
They just don't know that they need that right now.
They don't know. Right.
You got to let them know they need it.
I want to say, too, before we make it absolutely pointless, Jason, do you have Kickstarters before we take them all?
I actually do have one.
Okay, yeah, go for it. We should let him talk.
Sure.
I'll talk about Kiwi Chowdown.
Yeah.
We have 3 days left as of today. So when the episode drops, probably
maybe
done,
a day.
But
maybe
wow,
a day.
What a damn.
The only reason why to have that bell rung, so you know, you get this episode right away.
Look at that.
Get in there on the last minute, you know.
Right.
Back it.
So Kiwi Chowdown, it's from Detestable Games, Draco Studios, I'm pretty sure.
Or for Chicken Island.
It's like $59 for the base game. And it's like a card playing area majority game. It's pretty simple. It's not super complex. I actually like the way the card play works. And if you like area control and you think the Kiwi birds are cute, this is probably something you should check out. It's solid. Not necessarily my jam, but people will dig it. So Kiwi Chowdown.
They are cute.
They have good production value in their games. That's for sure. And it's totally funded, just so everybody knows.
Nice. It's over 1,000% or something.
Yeah.
Not enough.
Never enough.
So, anyways, Hoop, what you got?
Same one I talked about last week. I want to talk about it a little bit more. Mosaic, Astoria Civilization. You have till June 10th. It's 1 to 6 players. They just added on they call them slotted player boards. But
okay.
Like the
dual layer player boards.
You got wonders that you can build, text, different governments. Like I said, 1 to 6 players, plays in less than 2 hours, they say. There's two different types of tiers you can do. You can do the base game, the normal game, which is like $79. It's just cardboard punch-outs. Or for $149, you can add on all of the
That's the level
minis.
Jason's going to be pledging.
Yes.
At, I think,
yeah, I think that gets just in underneath
in.
Your... Yeah,
he doesn't back normally, games he can't pronounce. Yeah.
Mosaic?
I can say mosaic.
How'd you do that?
We said no prepping before the show.
But if you do back at the classes, it's like 350 high quality little like minis and tiles.
Oh,
that take place the tiles.
Totally back in
yeah. That. I'm really hoping that they do a sun drop kind of on there. It's not listed yet, but hopefully they will. And they're also including a big box that will include fits everything.
And it's Forbidden Games, so they've done like Raccoon Tycoon. Yep. Lizard Wizard was one of their most recent Kickstarters. Mm-hmm. So
Glenn Drover's.
Yeah, is this a Glenn Drover?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
He's a friend.
Yeah, friend.
I wish.
Yeah, friend. Yeah.
If we keep saying it,
if we keep
it will
saying
happen,
it,
right?
That's right. It becomes reality.
It's like Lacerda.
Whether you accept my invite or not, my friend request or not.
That's right.
not that
and
I'm bitter.
Had,
yeah.
Lacerda watch a live stream once. So.
See,
there you go.
Yeah,
there's always hope.
Glenn Drover sent Bob a cease and desist once.
Yeah, it's framed. That's on my wall.
I feel like we're getting there.
Yeah,
we're getting
steps,
there.
Maybe steps.
The only crowdfunding I have is unfortunately it looks like Gutterfall isn't going to succeed.
Oh, really?
Yeah, but it sounds like they're going to go kind of go back to the drawing board, and it's not the gameplay itself, but more of like the art design and some of the.
I will say I did bring that up in our video.
Right.
I don't think it was bad, but there were some things I would have done differently that maybe would have sold it better.
And I think that that was
sold the marketing. I'm saying better.
Right. And I think that's that first impression, right, of people just looking at stuff.
Sure.
So Dan, do you think they're doing this because of what you said?
Right. No.
Yeah.
They're doing this because money.
Don't give Dan anything, please. Please don't give him anything.
But
I got one.
That's it. Okay.
Actually,
it is a fun game. Go check out our video or their Kickstarter. They have stuff.
I really genuinely enjoyed it.
A deck building, social deduction, you know, kind of thing. Interesting system.
Yeah, and the deck building. The nice thing about the deck building is when you go to a location to get a card, you actually get to go through that stack of cards
and pick
the card you want.
So much.
So it's not random.
Right.
So which means that Dan won't cry about it later about not getting cards.
Well, you know, there's a difference between that and literally just saying, rolling a die and saying, did I win or lose? You know, that's different.
Oh, boy.
Isn't that like every Ameritrash game in the world?
No, there's I win, I lose, I kind of win, I kind of lose. There's all these options.
Oh, yeah. All right, Spencer, what do you got for crowdfunding?
All right, well, I usually like to do one from new people. I usually like word ones, and sometimes I'll throw in a party game. This is all three. It's called Word Royale.
Okay.
The idea is every player, it's like 3 to 8 players, will get 3 random letters of the alphabet.
Oh, I didn't click on this one. Yeah, okay.
And
oh, now you're
then
listening.
Everyone will get a subject, fruit.
Okay.
And you have to then say, in order, one item that starts with a letter, one of the 3 letters you have going down, and you can't repeat. Uh-huh. And the last, once you repeat or can't get one in the timer, the time limit, you're out for that round, and it goes until there's only one person left. That person wins the card.
You can't repeat what anyone has said?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, you know, I don't know.
Okay.
Just but it might not count because there might only be 26 cards, and thus...
Oh, one of each letter. Sure.
One of each letter. So, yeah, it's just this cute little game. It shouldn't take too long.
If there was only one of each letter, you could never repeat.
Well, no, see, if I have A, C, and B, and
actually,
I go...
Actually.
See why that game's fun?
And I use apple and cantaloupe and bananas, and then I get back to me again.
I can't use apples the second time. Okay, you
got to
keep going.
Yeah.
Got it.
So
this reminds me of a drinking game I...
You don't
there, yeah.
Actually they say it can be a drinking game.
Yeah, yeah, so. Actually.
There you go.
And I have one dead. More. I like it because it's a story game. It's called Journey of Akira. Akira.
Okay.
I'll get it. this one goes till June 7th. It's a 2 to 4 player, very light RPG, but the thing I think is cool about this one is the GM is going to switch out. And the person who's the GM is going to pull up a card. And it's going to tell you what is going on according to what everyone else has on their cards. Mm-hmm. But you get to tell the story of it.
Sure.
So as you're telling the story of it, basically everyone is contributing to the story.
Right.
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 And I like that. Yeah.
That's nice.
That one's still June
7th. We've talked about this a lot. I still haven't played a game like that yet. Like the...
I love those.
Overlord.
But, oh, yeah.
iDark
Overlord.
iDark Overlord.
Yeah, those are fun.
I'm trying to get a book published, so... I like telling stories.
Well, stop trying and succeed.
Okay? Whoa.
Oh, and Word Royale, you have a while. It doesn't go down until June 30th.
See,
so.
Dan's been off, suspended, and he's just been bottling all of this up.
So much hatred.
And he's just
it's coming out.
Spewing this bile.
Yeah, you think I took a vacation from my job? It's from this place. I need to get away.
Suspension. So actually that segues nicely into our topic.
Into our topic.
That Jason has been kind enough to pick. So Jason, I'm going to let you talk about what our topic is and define it a little bit.
Jason, I'm going to let you talk about it.
Thank you.
Permission.
Thank you, sir. Yeah. So basically, when I go into a game store and I pick up a game box and I see this word thing,
$50
topic, I immediately put the game back down. So this is basically a list of things that if we see it on a box and we know it about the game, you instantly return the box to the shelf and pretend like you didn't see it and didn't touch it. Mm-hmm. That kind of thing.
Yeah. Yeah. I like it. Or
so,
I don't like
so
it.
So Jason brings his first topic, and it's extremely negative.
Well, I do best, sir.
We knew Dan was coming back. That's
Like Dan, before we started, put on a bib and was sharpening like a knife and a fork. Yeah. Like he's ready to go.
I just got to point out the very start of the topic. I honestly I talked to Tim slightly about this because we're kind of similar in this regard, but. There's very few things like this for me personally. Like I just like playing games. Now, obviously, it's very different if I was going to buy a game because money's tough and I just don't tend to buy a lot of games.
Sure.
But if we're just talking about a game, okay, you're going to try playing this game and I looked at it, there are so few things that would say, I don't think this is going to be for me and like just not even try.
Right.
Like I just love playing games. So I'll play a game even if I hate it afterwards.
Yep.
I played it.
Sure.
You know, and so this is tough, honestly. This is kind of a difficult...
Which is funny because you notoriously enjoy hating some games.
Right, and so I'm going to have to try to figure out those games and talk about that, I guess, right?
Because then you'll love those games because you hate them immediately.
Right.
You don't have to bother with playing it. You can just hate it now.
Okay, so Jason, what's one of your first ones?
All right, so to be fair, I'm in the same boat as Dan. I'll play most games as well. I do. I would rather play a Euro game, but I would give anything a go. So I will clarify that. Now let's get to the negative. All right.
So much positive. I'm right. Done.
So the first thing that would probably be a big turnoff to me is roll to resolve for anything. I despise that with the fire of a thousand burning suns. I don't want to roll a die.
Even Stone Age?
And it determines what I can do if I'm successful. I hate that so much. And that would probably be one. If I saw it, I would put it back and move on.
So no D&D.
I hate D&D.
I will say very few game boxes say roll to resolve on them. Like that's, you got to do some research.
That's true.
actually, I don't know. I got nothing. But yeah, okay, roll to resolve. Yeah, I guess that doesn't bother me because then, I mean, stuff like that, usually in games now, especially newer games, there's ways to mitigate die rolls and stuff like that.
So, right, like that's one of the things with Stone Age, right? Stone Age, if you just look immediately, is this, you know, wow, luck, like this resource management where you're just luck. But no, there's quite a few ways to mitigate that and work on that.
Sure, sure. But okay, roll to resolve. Well, Bob and I play enough territory control kind of games where you're chucking dice. I mean, Axis and Allies.
Yeah.
We're kind of desensitized.
I was
going to
say, how small, Jason, have you played Robinson Crusoe?
I have.
So like, that the tiny weather die resolve kind of thing, is that even kind of what you're talking about?
I don't love it. It's mostly like if I'm planning this whole turn and then, you know, I'm adding a result to a die to determine if I'm successful or not. I hate that part. Like, I don't mind the randomness of a die. It's just...
It's not like he hates Takenoko because
I'll actually say I'm pretty similar on that than I would say. Obviously, I get made fun of a lot for hating luck, right? I don't hate luck, but there are times that is subjective, right, where I just feel like the luck is getting in the way of something for me personally. Like it's just too strong. Even if it's just the theme of the luck is too strong, it can affect me. But I tend to agree that if one of the most hated things for me in gaming in general is where the game is designed around an idea that you're setting a bunch of stuff up in one tiny decision at the end that may not even be your decision can ruin everything. Mm-hmm. And I hate that just in general. Now, again, that's something you wouldn't find on a box, right? But that idea, I can see where you're coming from.
Yeah, I'm not saying everything has to be on a box. Like if somebody brought the game over and I looked at it. Like, you know, let's not take the box thing literally.
Sure. No. You think you could look at a box and figure it out? Right.
Maybe it's after you've played a few rounds and you've gotten your first actual impression of the game.
Right.
Do you want to continue? Do you want to put the game away and never touch it again?
Yeah.
Sure. Sure. Bob, you got one? You got something you hate?
Yeah, it's actually kind of funny that you guys said something about it earlier, but like, games like the iDark Overlord.
Or, oh, you don't like those?
Or like the one where you were like trying to do like the movie pitches.
Oh, right, B-movie.
Yeah.
Or we got like to play an early version of that
the Blockbuster
for
movie. Yeah, like something where it's so left up to like a subjective or subjective...
Knowledge?
No, or... not knowledge, but like, I'm going to come up with this like
it's just
crazy theory.
Oh, yeah.
And then you guys are saying, yeah, no. I mean, because then it's just like, okay,
like
why'd you say no? Well, see, that's a little bit different, because at least then it's like you don't know whose is whose.
Okay,
and you're just
fair.
Picking the best one. It's
fair
not
enough.
Like how well someone can spin some BS.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
And then it's not like, well, his story was better than your story, so I'm going to vote for him. It's
right.
Like,
no, I get that.
Yeah.
I get that. And it's tough if you're playing with people you don't know, and you don't know how to like cater to the audience.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah.
Yep.
So, yeah, I get that.
Yeah. That's probably my biggest, like, because, like I said, I'll play just about anything. Like I said, I played that. I'm sure we had fun doing it, but, like, if I go to the store and I saw that's what the game's about, I'm probably not going to buy it.
Right. Yeah, I mean, like you, a lot of times, sometimes it's just, like, picking a game based on, like, who can I get? Can I get this played? Like,
right.
Oh, I'd really love to have this game, but if I'm never going to get it played, like, maybe I will spend that money on something else. Spencer, what do you hate when you... pick up a box and look at it?
Oh, it's not going to be something for when I pick up a box and look at it.
Okay. What do you hate in a game?
Like
what's
you
a mechanic
said earlier,
or something that drives you?
I'm a game omnivore.
Yeah.
You can hand me a game. I'll play it.
So nothing to copy.
I was even thinking really hard about an IP. Like, is there an IP I really hate? And I was like, yeah, there are several IPs I really hate. But if you handed me a game with that IP, I'd still play it. I don't like The Godfather. But I like playing the Godfather of the game.
You're so
you
wrong.
Just
please don't. So Jason,
don't leave
if you
want
to come and be a permanent member on the show, you're welcome to come. We got an opening.
Godfather's great. I love
Godfather's great game.
It is great.
It's a great game.
So what I hate about sometimes when you find in a game is when the game prevents you from actually playing the game. At some point,
you are
stuck. You either have no choices. You're just doing. The one thing you get to do.
This is kind of a warm topic for you from today.
Oh,
a little bit.
A little bit. You're stuck doing only one thing. You're eliminated before you even have a chance to play the game. Mm. Or all of your choices are just, they don't have any result. They're inconsequential.
Sure.
That kind of thing. I'm like, I'm here to play a game. I'm not here to just sit on my butt and waste time.
Right, right.
I want to make choices. I really hate it when that happens in a game, when it gives you the ability to not play.
Sure.
That's interesting, because there's a lot of that.
There is a
in
lot.
Nemesis.
I will say, this
right
is true.
He opened the door.
That can happen in Nemesis. Like, however, if you get eliminated very early, you can come back as the intruders. And I've never seen two people get eliminated really quick.
And the awesome thing is when you're an intruder, you have variable health. So who knows if you may never die. It's amazing.
Worst
No, I tend to agree, though. I hear the argument about Nemesis all the time, not to go on that tangent, that like player elimination sucks and this game handles it poorly. I disagree. I've played it quite a few times. I have never had someone sit out for a long time. Usually, yep. Once one person dies, it either starts a domino effect of
everyone dying.
Or one person dies early, and then they're an alien the whole game, and then the end game happens eventually where everyone else dies or gets out. Like, so I don't get that argument. But
the only other thing that I've seen happen is someone will play, everyone else has left the ship. Everyone else is either dead or they left the ship. There's only one person left. But then the game goes really, really fast because I'm the only one making choices.
Right, nothing's
boom,
in their
boom,
way.
Boom, 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 boom. Oh, look,
but anyway, I get what you're saying. It's just, it's interesting how you can also love a game with that stuff in it depending on how it's
right.
How it's
One of mine is going to have a thing that I love and I hate. Right. The same thing. Yep. So, Dan, what do you got? What you got?
Boy, if a game has the art style of Dinosaur Island, I will just ignore. No, I honestly, I don't know. Give me some time to think. I didn't write stuff down. I'm kind of going warm with this. That's why I jumped in early with the thing I agreed with.
So one of mine, I guess, and this is very specific, I think, is if it's an IP, but it's like a funky version of that IP where like the art is weird or like it doesn't really... It shares a name only with the IP, and nothing else really associates it with the IP. For example, the Blade Runner.
I knew you were going to say this. I think you're getting a little strong language-wise on how it doesn't associate, but I that's the first thing I thought of when you said it.
I mean,
as well.
Very loosely associated.
Sure.
Right? You're like, oh, I love Blade Runner. Awesome movie. Here's a game based on it, and it's going to be like a social deduction game, and it's like, I mean, this is a card game.
It's because someone should have made my Blade Runner game idea that we talked about in that video.
Probably.
Just saying. Perfect game.
But yeah, sometimes IPs can turn me off. Like so there's a game that just was on Kickstarter a little while ago, like The Librarians.
Never watched the show.
That show.
I like the show.
So
I've never seen the show, and it's like unless I am at like Jason's house and somebody like brings that game out and is like, hey, we're gonna play this. Mm-hmm. I would never touch it. I probably wouldn't even pick the box up off the shelf to see
or like the ICP deck building game. Like,
right.
Now, I would pick that up because I'd have been like, what the hell?
Sure,
is
that's
going to
turn a lot of people off.
That was great.
Though, for sure.
But no, that I would look at for sure. But I mean, just like a rando sci-fi show that, like, it's like I'm aware that the show exists, but fine, whatever. And I would just leave it. And it's not like I'll never play that, but it's an instant turnoff, right? You look at it, you go, I'm not interested.
Kind of like variable health.
Exactly like variable health. That is a mechanic that it's like, nope, I'm out. Like, we got to house rule this.
Mm-hmm. You know what? I got something that actually happens to me all the time, and this is a kind of weird one, and I do buy games like this, but it's like way less than I do, right? So if I pick up a game, I've talked about this a lot on the show, and it says, this game's for 6 to 10 players. I go, I'll never get that many people to play. So I just put it back immediately, sure, right? Like, I have a couple games. Like, I do have Captain Sonar because I think that when you do get it played, it's one of the best experiences ever.
I love Captain Sonar.
But I get that game played once every 2 years.
Right.
So, you know, but still, like, so if I pick up a game and, like, the player count starts at even, I would say 5 is okay, but if the player count, like, starts at 6, I don't.
Sure. You are obsessed with Blood together. On the Clock Tower.
I'm obsessed with Blood, but you can play that digitally easily. Right? And it helped once we started running our Meeple and stuff like that. That's like, okay, I know I have a time once a month I can get people together and we can play Captain Sonar and stuff. But yes, for a long time, that was a big thing for me where Catherine and I had this conversation all the time. We'd pick up a game, this looks really cool, never mind, literally can't play it.
Yeah. Sure.
You know?
Yeah.
So,
piggyback off of that, that's something I've looked at too and have actually turned down, which is kind of ironic because some of my favorite games are very limited, like the player count. If it says, 3 or 4 players only, only 2 players.
Starfarers.
Yeah. So it's like, man, it's very limiting, probably not going to play it. But like Rebellion, Love it.
Oh, two players.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
but
so,
you and I, it's like, oh, if we can get 2 hours, like, mm-hmm. you know, 2.5 hours, we will sit and play Rebellion
yep.
and have the best time
yep.
ever.
But that is one yeah. of my bigger turnoffs, too, though, is like by limiting that player count by so much, it's like,
sure.
So you never know if you're going to have, like, more than two people or right. you're going to sure. have like, right. not enough people.
Even though it's funny how that turns around, though, because usually those games that say 3 to 4 players only will play way better than the game that says 2 to 6, because the game that says 2 to 6 is really 4, 3 to 5.
Yeah.
And they say it's 2 to 6 because it increases sales. So
sure.
crazy.
Right.
So
right.
yeah, it's kind of funny though how it's like, I don't want them to, you know, I don't want it to be so limited. And they're like Starfarers
right, we'll
and Starfarers and Catan could say okay, 2 to 6, and
yeah.
you're like, then thanks. And then you play a 2-player game, you're like, this sucks.
Or like, when you have a 2-player game and the 2-player rules say, well, you basically have to invent a 3rd player to play. I'm like,
right.
Yeah.
Like, just make it a 3-player game.
Just put that on
right,
there.
Right. Okay. So Jason, you got another. I know you got more. I know there's plenty of things you hate about games.
I have like a whole list.
Yeah. Oh, go run
go
down the list. Run down the list.
Unscroll
the airing
parchment.
Of grievances. Yes.
The next one that I despise, probably more than the first one, is real time.
Oh,
I love
real time.
Real time. Real time games are awful. Like, they're hard to teach.
Sure.
And if you can get through the teach, then if someone doesn't feel comfortable playing, then you have to basically play for you and for them.
Yeah.
So I don't know. It just. It adds undue stress to a game that I don't think is necessarily needed.
Sure.
So I would just rather remove that from the game and play something else.
Yeah.
I don't play with noobs.
While I don't agree, I do totally understand, and I do accept that it's like the player count thing, where it's mm-hmm. something that instantly limits. Right, you see real time, yeah. you're just like, okay, well, not very many people are going to want to play this.
Yep.
It's going to be hard to teach. Yeah, mm-hmm. So I totally do get that. Do you enjoy Captain Sonar that we just talked about?
I like the 2-player one.
Okay, so I just talked about how I played Sonar. Yeah, that's okay.
And I like the Temple Escape from the Temple, whatever that is.
Oh yeah, Escape. Yeah.
Yeah, I like that one. It's fine, but it's not my jam.
Yeah,
really.
But like XCOM, one's really tricky.
So
it's
good.
Timed, and you're and like, people are trying to do their own thing, but
I
you're
like,
trying to do your
I
own
like
thing.
The
XCOM is great.
I like the pressure. Oh. I do.
XCOM is like if Vast was real time, and I love it. Or like if Root was real time, and except cooperative, obviously. But man, I love that. That insane asymmetric and real time. What?
Yeah.
Oh, I love it.
Yeah, it's good.
Talk
it's
about solid. One of the hardest games to teach ever.
Yeah, it's super hard to teach, though.
Here's your book. Read it. You got 10 minutes. All
right? Well, it does have the tutorial app that goes through everyone's turn for them and stuff. But still, if that wasn't there, I think it would genuinely might be the most difficult game. Okay, so not only are you doing something that no one else does and you have to know how to do, also, you have 10 seconds to do it. Have fun.
Go.
Oh, that's crazy.
Oh, man.
Well, what else you got, Jason?
Let's see. Minis.
Yeah. Anyway, what do you have, Spencer?
Apart from being wrong about that one, what else you got?
What a ridiculous one.
Now,
minis are just unnecessary. They could be anything.
I disagree.
It's just a waste of money, in my opinion.
They could be anything.
Yeah, but opinions are wrong.
Yes. However,
your opinion is objectively incorrect.
I appreciate the eye candy. You know,
yeah,
it's like,
I mean,
man, that looks so cool.
I enjoy a game with good table presence.
Yeah. I completely find it situational. I do enjoy minis, but obviously a big problem with me enjoying minis is I hate when games are expensive, and then those tend to go hand in hand, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Now, I will say, though, an argument I make all the time is like, so minis in Nemesis aren't really necessary. They're cool. They're not really necessary.
Mm-hmm.
I think minis...
in any game.
Well, again, Jason, this is something I want to talk about because I don't know if you've played Lords of Hellas, but there is an expansion pack for Lords of Hellas that adds miniature terrain to the game that I genuinely think makes the game better.
Yes.
Because it is, and I don't think they did this on purpose as a money grab kind of thing, but there's art on the board that shows you where the temples are and stuff, right? But with the pieces moving on, it's an area control game, there's a lot of stuff going on. Even if you had tokens, there's a lot of stuff going on that board. So just replacing them with 3D buildings that where you can see everything is so much better. It helps the gameplay. It helps to teach.
Yeah.
You know, there's also cities in Lords of Hellas where there's cities on the board, and all that city does is, sure, it looks cool, but also when you put your unit in it, there's a little square in it that like would hold a cube that holds your unit, showing everyone this guy's in this city.
But now Jason's going to say that could be a cube and not a mini.
Well,
sure,
it's not a mini.
But the thing
is,
you're gonna get cubes on that board. You could cover up all the stuff on the board, and it's like, oh, hang on, let me check all the iconography on that.
Right. I'm just saying that on the normal board, you would put your unit standing on the city. But if the board gets bumped or anything like that,
right.
So I'm just saying, I do think that is a situation where that not super expensive expansion just adds a couple miniatures that genuinely make the game easier to play and teach. And I think that is an example that is far and few between. You are correct, but I do think that's an example where I'm like, I appreciate that expansion quite a bit.
I cannot play Cthulhu Wars without
Nurgles. You can, actually. Sure, we've done can. It. It's called Cthulhu Wars Duel.
Yeah. Standees. So.
It would be a lot easier to store.
Although I would like to point out that in some games, when you have minis, those minis of various sizes, the standees usually aren't of various sizes. And if I want to look at the, just look at the board and go like, I don't want to go there because there's a giant guy over there, and that's probably bad.
I right? guess that is, though, that would come to me as bad design of standees, then. In Cthulhu Wars Duel, the standees are different shapes and sizes.
That is correct. Oh,
very nice.
So
I had to play that.
It's a cool game.
Yeah.
The problem is the player count. It's two players.
What's wrong with you guys? I've played it.
Yeah.
Oh, now you got me in trouble. I'm in trouble. Jerk.
But yes, we know your hatred towards minis, and I can't disagree.
It's
with
well documented.
The negatives, I think, do outweigh the positives. I just enjoy the positives.
Yeah, so. No, I mean, it's some of it, I think, is just because of my background, right? I came up playing miniature games, and I'm tiny, so I associate with them. But no, I came up playing Warhammer and stuff like that.
Sure.
And so, you know, tactical war games, and they lend themselves to having miniatures, even Axis and Allies, right?
And we got friends like Greg and Pete who paint badass miniatures. It's
I'm sorry, we've talked about this. Axis and Allies, those aren't miniatures. Those are pieces.
Right.
They are pieces. Yeah,
action figures.
But,
action figures.
But yeah. Star Wars Rebellion absolutely needs all the miniatures.
Yes. Sure. Yeah. Those are, again, they're such, like, they are miniatures, yes, but, like, also, are they? They're so small, and, you know, they're almost
they're
just
miniatures.
Sure, I get it. You can just say that about anything, though. Like,
no, we can't.
I
can't
it.
Say this deck of cards is miniatures.
Like, the little...
Well, it's a small deck.
I know you guys don't know what I'm talking about, probably, but, like, the tiny guys I was just talking about in Lords of Hellas, you're just little
hoplites,
warrior guys.
Yeah.
Your hoplites. Those are not miniatures.
No, they
I hate this. I hate this conversation. Jason, get me out of here. What's the next on your list. I hate this so much.
Bail.
He is not
you're going to hate this one too.
Okay, that's fine.
I hate cooperative games.
Yeah. Because you were like co-op, this and that. I'm like, oh, Jason doesn't like co-ops. He doesn't like. You
now,
know what's funny
I
though?
I have some co-ops that I like.
Yeah, because you've been playing
be
a lot
a
of
theme
one
that
lately.
I enjoy.
You've been playing a lot of a specific co-op, right? Marvel United. You bet,
oh, yes.
Like
I do like Marvel
lot,
United a lot.
Right? I haven't played
Isn't
that yet.
Isn't that a kid's game? I'm just kidding.
Oh, wow.
Does it have miniatures in it, though?
It does.
It
so
miniatures.
It's a co-op miniatures game, and you really like it. Maybe you should revisit the list.
Is it real time?
Is it real time, too?
No.
Okay.
Are there dice rolling?
Nope.
No, okay. There's not. No.
Thought you had them.
I thought I had them.
Okay, so I actually say it's funny. I agree. I actually tend to prefer competitive to cooperative any day of the week.
Sure.
I just, like him, though, there are times that I
it depends
do
on the
really
theme.
Enjoy
Man,
that.
Man, I love a good, tough co-op, though.
Right,
like
exactly.
Really
if I'm playing a co-op, I want a nice difficult. I want a Robinson Crusoe. I want an XCOM. I want that.
Black
Orchestra. We really have to work together. Like, that's
you
what I want.
You want to have a co-op where one person doesn't become the alpha and everyone else just sits back and does what he says.
We're not talking about Pandemic.
But you also don't want to have a competitive game where you have one person becomes the alpha and everyone else just becomes fodder.
Right. Yeah, you got to kind of really limit the micromanaging. Cause that's one of the things about Spirit Island I don't like, where it's like you could spend 30 minutes trying to optimize the perfect turn. I'd rather just have it be you take your turn, I take, you know, and I'm gonna take my turn. And it's like, yeah, you have these tokens, like, okay, I'm gonna worry about this, you know, like you put it on a location, so you're like, I'm taking care of this, you don't have to worry about it, but you're not gonna go into super specific detail
that's,
in how you're gonna handle it.
That's one
it.
Of the things I don't like about Spirit Island as
yeah.
well.
Yeah.
Yeah. One of the 95 things I nailed to the
oh,
door.
Boy. Oh boy. Why do we even
historical
do this?
Reference. Yeah. I'll give you a point.
Yeah. Okay. So Jason doesn't like minis.
What is a
doesn't
cooperative
like
you really like that's like kind of more popular, I guess, or something, right?
I like Marvel United.
Yeah.
I like Black Orchestra.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Freedom the Underground Railroad.
I still haven't played that yet. Yeah. It looks
it's
cool.
So good and so brutal, and the theme is like it crushes you when you lose one of the slave cubes. It's awful.
Mm-hmm.
And I can play Robinson Crusoe, but I don't love it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sure.
Okay.
Man.
Those are good ones.
Yeah.
Awesome. So again, I think you like the good ones.
Yeah.
that's good.
Do you have any more on the list, or is that it?
Oh no, Jason's got a
he's
lot.
Got,
of
he's got a huge
like.
List. He's not saying co-op.
Yeah.
We should.
I'll say one more.
Okay.
All right.
Programming games.
Oh, I love
Mechs. Mechs versus Minions. You don't like
so
that one?
Much.
Well, that's got a couple strikes. One, minis. Two,
cooperative.
Co-op. Three,
good
programming.
Art.
Yep.
Good art.
four, it's
art.
Fun.
Terrible.
Five, it's fun. Six, it's fun.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I talk about this quite a bit on the show. I haven't played very many program games, so I'm looking forward to.
There aren't that many out there.
Sure, I guess.
Yeah.
No, they are out there.
Like, I've played as the birds in Root.
Sure.
Right? So that's something, but yeah. I haven't really played
Gosh.
Much.
I just love Mechs vs. Minions.
It's great.
Was that one I played? It was Robo Rally or something?
Robo Rally?
Yeah, yeah.
I haven't played that.
That's a big programming game.
Yeah.
Mm. So I don't know about you guys, but sometimes a theme in a game where it's like the popular theme and all the games are coming out are this theme.
Oh, sure.
Then I'm done.
Well,
right?
Like
yeah.
I was Vikings for a while.
It was Vikings for a while. And I think that was a strike against Champions of Midgard because it was like
the 80th.
Well,
yeah.
Sure. Viking themed game
right.
to come out in like a year
sure.
and a half.
Yeah.
Right. And so Blood Rage, I played early and I really liked.
Mm-hmm.
And then
even though it's garbage.
Fire and Axe, we played. It was pretty good. And then there was
I
another
hadn't played
one.
Fire and Axe.
Oh, I thought you
actually
played with Pete and I.
Oh, maybe I did.
Yeah, like when it first came out, like Pete had it or something
yeah,
like that.
I guess I did play it, mm-hmm. but it didn't even make that much of an impression. It was fine.
Yeah, I enjoyed it.
But I guess so. I don't like Viking themed games for some reason.
Not anymore.
And like I kind of did the same thing with zombie games, right? Like I played Zombicide. It's
and
fine.
There was the other
Zombicide, like,
and then the other Zombicide.
Played
and
City
the
of the
Zombicide.
Dead.
Dead
like,
of Winter.
Fine, whatever. Didn't love Dead of Winter
game.
That much. You know, whatever. But I love zombie movies. Mm. But then I played Zombicide Black Plague, and I really liked that one. So, I mean, maybe it's just the right iteration. But there was a time where it's like, oh, zombie games.
Well,
what about
Cthulhu? Cthulhu has saturated forever.
Right, it's the definition.
It is omnipresent.
It's omnipresent.
He's here with us
he
even
is above.
Now.
You got a Cthulhu up there.
He is.
He's literally above us.
He's
I
here
was
right
saying.
Now.
Yeah. Yeah. He's always
looking down.
No, I guess I feel like that... The Cthulhu theme is different because there's not like a
you like it.
Year and a half glut of Cthulhu-themed games.
It's like, 10 years.
No, it's a constant trickle of
every,
Cthulhu
Yeah, it's a constant
games.
Trickle, right, where it's not like everything is this theme for now, and then it will be a different thing.
I can't even name or number the number of Cthulhu-themed games I've played in my lifetime. It's
so many.
Yeah. That,
so
I mean, many. You get to like 36, and you're like, what comes next?
I know.
37.
Oh, was
I've
it
played
really?
Like three, and that's enough.
No wait, you've got one you actually like though, the Kingsport Festival.
Kingsport Festival, yeah,
yeah
I like
know
that
you
one.
Like that one.
Well,
but it's got dice rolling in it.
Really huge into Cthulhu.
Yeah, but it's like dice worker placement, so that's different.
It's a little different. Okay,
fair enough.
So, have you played Euphoria?
I knew he was going to say that.
I have played Euphoria.
Did you care for that?
That's not Cthulhu.
No,
but it's dice rolling worker placement.
I know. Bob's
oh yeah,
going...
yeah, I'm fine with that.
Okay,
Bob's,
that's
Bob's going back to like a half hour ago.
Yeah, I'm still catching up.
We're going to need you to call back later tonight
yeah.
so that when we get to
the more
part,
questions I have, yeah. I can talk about Cthulhu now. When it pops
He's
up.
Going to go through every single game he knows and see if you like
okay,
it.
Okay, hang on.
Bob will just be sitting in a dark room with one little light on him.
Bing.
But, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of potential instant turnoffs for games, mm-hmm. I guess. For me, theme is big, potentially. I will try most mechanics. I guess here's one, time length, right? If a game takes 4 hours or more, maybe not.
See,
maybe
I'm still
not.
Good with her.
Give it to
it.
Me, baby.
Because I'll just start the game and leave it set up and then come back to another day.
See, you
cats.
Have cats. I can't
cats.
Do that.
I got three of them.
Yeah, my cats are jerks.
Yeah. Oh.
Same. Well, yeah.
You know, I'm just knocking everything around. No, I mean... I really want to play Dune. I know Dune's going to take
Later,
a long time.
Child.
I really want to play Dune too.
I enjoy Twilight Imperium, but I like playing it when time. Everybody already knows how to play and we can play it in like 3 or 4 hours.
I guess that's every game though.
And
yeah.
not 4 to 12 hours. So game length.
I have
can
never,
be...
the first time I played Twilight Imperium,
yeah.
they were all new people, of course. It was our first time.
Sure.
I mean, it took like 5 hours, maybe 4 hours.
How many players did you have?
It was more than four players.
Okay.
I don't know. It was. I just don't understand this. Like, are you guys playing with the most like
AP
yes.
people?
Yeah, the
yes.
most
sometimes
AP people.
Yeah.
Ever.
Sometimes I've had an 8-hour game.
Or
it's
super conservative people who don't want to try to push.
I guess I hear these numbers for Twilight Imperium time, and I'm just like, the what is it? The rumors of my death have been greatly exaggerated.
Yeah.
Or whatever. Like, I don't understand. I don't understand people saying this. Like, I'm not playing a game for 8 hours. I'm like, yeah, me neither. Mm-hmm. What are you playing? You're playing Twilight Imperium 3 times? Like, what are you playing?
I wish.
But anyway.
That'd be awesome.
And yet, my wife would be willing to sit down and binge watch a TV show for 12 hours straight. But
yeah.
she won't
yeah.
play a game.
Oh, dude, that's like yeah, Sarah Beck, I don't want to watch a movie. Let's watch 4 episodes
oh
of this
gosh,
crime
yes.
show that's an hour long. What? Okay.
That's 4 hours. We could have watched Endgame.
Yeah,
I could have
exactly.
played Nemesis
Again.
once. Half of once.
See, Nemesis needs to be shorter.
So Nemesis, I do agree, should be shorter. But you can, again, the reason Nemesis takes so long is because people aren't active enough. They're so scared. You know, right. they wait
to game's
do everything.
Terrifying. Tim,
just watch. Let it kill you.
Yeah.
Why won't you let me kill
play
you?
Play to learn, not to win.
Hey, Jason, have you played it?
Oh, yeah. I just got done playing it before I got on here.
No, so you have
Nemesis. Yeah. Nemesis?
Yeah.
Yeah. Minis.
Yeah, I have three
co-op.
Oh, yeah.
Space.
I'm just saying, Dice maybe rolling. If you haven't played it, maybe shut up.
Dice, roll to resolve.
Co-op.
It's got everything that Jason loves in a game. He literally named
every... Oh, he just ticked off every box that he's...
Right. I actually wanted to say, so if you don't like co-op, I assume you hate... semi-co-op, because semi-co-op is that co-op, but then also like
not
this weird
trader,
deduction and you know this co-op. Kind of,
yes, I do despise that.
Yeah,
I like semi-co-op.
I think you have three copies of Nemesis.
I love semi-co-op.
I like semi-co-op.
Semi-co-op.
I think what we've learned today, gentlemen, is everyone has exceptions to the rules.
Right.
Oh, for sure.
Right. Yeah. Well, for example, growl. Right. We were talking about growl earlier. Because Jason's a good sport, we were all actually playing games in the same place. We're like, hey, let's just play this game real quick. Normally, that is a game that Jason would probably pull off the shelf and go, nope, and put it right back. But instead,
probably wouldn't have even taken it off the shelf, honestly.
Right. Well, you might have been like, what's this fuzzy blue
thing?
Yeah,
what's this weird mouth game?
True. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But then you sit down and you play it, and you're like, oh yeah. Normally, again, these are mechanics that he doesn't normally seek out, mm-hmm. right, in a game. But then you play it more and more and more, and you start to have a better time. Yeah. And you know, so sometimes it's worth playing the game that may have that instant turn off.
It's good to have an open mind.
And as much as we joke about like hating things, the nice thing is that like when we did our game day with Jason and Katie, like everybody just was down to play whatever. You know, and it was really cool. With the exception of Dan, everybody's really fun to play games with.
Right.
So, you know, we can all just sit and play games and have a good time.
It's not my fault you guys kept playing games that sucked, you know?
Oh, boy.
Common
until,
denominator.
Hold on. This is not math class. I will say we didn't only play
the lowest
games that
common
sucked. Which ones did I win?
Mask of the Red Death.
That was a good
that
game.
That was a good game.
ICP.
I won something else. ICP, that was a pretty good game. But I think that was it.
Homestretch.
Oh, did I win that? That was a really good game.
Which is funny because you don't like luck-based games, and Homestretch is the luckiest of luck-based games.
Again, that Homestretch to me is it's a party game,
it's
you
the
know.
Exception.
And I just it is not the same as like Lords of Vegas. The, you know,
right.
maybe not as luck-based. Yeah, blah blah blah. I mean, it's not as luck-based kind of idea, but the theme of it, the Vegas theme. I talk about this all. I don't like the gambling Vegas theme. It instantly turns me off. There's something for you. The gambling Vegas instantly turns me off. I just don't care about that world. And so that turns me off. And then there's the luck in it. And then there's the meanness in it, which is another thing I don't like. Gabe. So Lords of Vegas just binds a lot of things that I don't like, and I didn't hate playing the game. It was fine.
Yeah.
I just think it's a little overhyped for what it is for me.
Sure.
Right.
Sure. It's classic. It's great.
sure. Wrong.
Actually, everything you just said.
Wrong.
Everyone in this room is now dumber.
You're all now dumber.
Dr. Malcolm.
That's right.
All right. Well, this has been fun. This has been a good.
Was that your whole list, sir?
Good enough.
Yeah, we covered it all.
You got it. We got it all. Okay. Yeah. Well, this was good. Jason, I really appreciate you being our guinea pig.
Thanks for coming.
For our first
Thanks for having me.
Skype guest.
Hopefully, we'll see if this actually recorded
hopefully
and
actually works.
Uploaded. Yeah.
And you're not just watching us laughing
right here.
Apropos of the topic, normally Jason would like log on, see Dan, and then just log right back.
Right.
But he stuck around, so that was cool.
That was nice.
Things I hate in games, Dan.
If I pick up the game and it says Dan, nope.
Will Dan be there? Don't be named Dan.
Welcome back.
We missed you.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, we didn't. But anyways, so be sure to check out Jason's Pretty Okay podcast and YouTube show.
Yep.
I mean, he's pumping out content all week, all the time. You don't even like have a... I mean, you drop your podcast, what, like super late Thursday night,
Thursdays.
Early Friday?
Yeah, Thursday. Yeah, Thursday.
I usually listen to it Friday morning, like driving to work. So I always associate it with Fridays. But
I usually listen to it 2 weeks after.
Like, oh, that's it.
Spencer takes in no content.
Yeah, he doesn't even watch our own show.
Yeah. So we're lucky he knows who you are. But yes, Jason's always got, what, you got unboxings. You've got, I mean...
reviews.
You get a lot of games early that you talk about, and people get to hear about the game before other people do. So
Jason gets stuff early. Not like a year in advance.
Right.
Normal early.
Yeah. Pretty
normal
sure he pays people.
More than the normal plebs out there.
Not like some shows where they get it a year and a half early and then you forget about the game and then they're like, oh yeah, we did this video a year ago.
Yeah.
You know. Yeah. But whatever. Anyways, so check them out on all their socials. Check them out. Find them on Facebook, right? Mm-hmm. Join the Riveted. Join our Facebook group. Mm-hmm. Ask to join our Facebook group because it's private. Because we like to keep it cool in there.
Yeah, nice community.
So find the Board Game Rundown on Facebook. Find hashtag the Riveted, right? It's hashtag the Riveted, all one word?
Yes.
Yeah, make sure I get that right.
Yep. Look out for the Meeple Gaming Society. If you're in the Michiana area, we're going to be starting up our meetups and be playing some board games.
Northern Indiana, Southern Michigan.
Yep.
Yeah, we're going to start doing some meetups again soon now that things are kind of opening back up.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And keep an eye out for the other videos we're going to be uploading this week. We got some big stuff coming, including an unboxing of the first wave of Nemesis. This week,
Jason
guys.
Is so sad he can't be
here. We haven't done any clicks today.
We haven't done any clicks. I just, my hands are tired.
I need to watch that Nemesis unboxing to see if it's a game that I should pick up a fourth copy.
That's a good idea. I need a fourth copy. You have three copies, but you haven't opened them yet. You need to see what it looks like to open one.
Did you back it for the fourth one also for lockdown?
Yeah.
In his head right now, he's saying, what is he talking about?
He dropped $4,000 and bought two copies of the game.
Yeah.
All in. So anyways, guys, as usual, thank you for watching. Please check out our 500 subscriber giveaway video. What? Do we have a snap?
I snapped.
Whoa. That's weird. Oh, Bob, do your thing. What else you got?
That's it.
Oh, you were starting to do that.
No, I was going to do the snap thing.
He beat you to it.
He beat me to it.
Oh, yeah. And also, check out our sister channel, the Miniatures Rundown, where CJ
Frank
and Jeff,
been on the show a couple times.
Paint stuff, do goofy things. Something Jason has zero interest in because it is All miniatures. All the time.
I've watched a couple, but it's not going much deeper than that.
Understandable, sir.
But so anyways, thank you guys for watching. Thanks for putting up with, Dan.
Yeah.
And
sorry.
For the Board Game Rundown, I've been Tim.
I've been Bob.
I've been Dan.
I've been Spencer.
Jason.
And I'm Jason, but not from the Board Game Rundown.
No, he's not. He's from the Board Game Mechanics, and they're pretty okay.
Board Game Rundown with Jason.
Jason. We'll see you next time.
Thanks for checking out the Board Game Rundown. If you like what you saw, like, comment, and subscribe to our channel. Share our videos on social media and spread the word. We publish new content weekly, including reviews, unboxing, and let's plays. And as always, thanks for watching.